Sportz Show.
Palmer stepping away at first. Palmer extending the play. Crosses the field. Larry Fitzgerald. Fitzgerald is going to take it into Green Bay territory.
The show exclusively known as the voice of the Arizona Cardinals fan club, the Bird Gang.
Fitzgerald inside the 30.
Now, with your host, Earl Burnett, a.k.a. Kazual E.
Bird Gang on three. One, two, three. Bird Gang.
And I am back again for the final edition for this week of the Kazual Sportz Show. And the first time we're going into a weekend. The first time we're going into a weekend coming off the Kazual Sportz Show. It has been one heck of a week. You want to go ahead and keep up with this show, you know what to do. Your fingers need to be dialing on your phone and go ahead and hitting our social media pages all over social media. Facebook, Facebook Live tonight, as we always do for every show. And Twitter, Instagram, and of course our YouTube page. All with the same tab, Kazual Sportz. That's K-A-Z with U-A-L, and there's a Z at the end of the word sports. So, also go ahead and download the mobile apps for iOS and Android at the website at www.ksrnaz.com. And if you haven't done so already, I would appreciate it if you would go ahead and subscribe to the other 2,000-plus members on the website to get the articles that go up on the website and other information from the network. So www.ksrnaz.com. And again, fans, as a reminder, all Bird Gang, Suns Nation, the Diamondback fans, fan clubs, I should say. Are you doing any events? If you're doing any events, I know it's really been kind of hard to do public events, of course, but if you're doing some type of event that you want to get some notoriety from and get all the Bird Gang, Suns Nation, so forth to flock to, maybe you're doing a Zoom meeting, maybe you got some type of charity thing you're doing or whatever it may be, this is your avenue to get it out to the public, get it out to all of the fan base. Call into the Kazual Sportz Show or go to the website at www.ksrnaz.com, and we will go ahead and get your stuff out and get it on live on the show or however way you choose for us to do that as far as that goes. We got another good show for you tonight. First of all, of course, I want to go ahead and thank all the guests that came in all this week. It was a pretty cool first week. We had Bruce Cooper come in early in the week. First of all, of course, I had my man Javon Adams come in on Monday. Then Tuesday, we had Coop come in. Wednesday, we had Kent Summers. Last night, we had the group from Insight Sportz Talk, two of the co-hosts of that show, Ed Cole and Paul Richardson. And so tonight it is I doing the solo tip, as of course, you know, we got to pound these phones and keep pounding these phones because the guests are going to keep coming in, and I'm going to give my fingers a break. So I'm going to do this thing solo tonight, and I might get, of course, a special 5-minute closet guest for my man, closet visit for my man Sean tonight. So we'll definitely be looking forward to that. I know he has a lot to say in such a short time about the Suns. So thank you again, Bird Gang, all you fans out there for listening and following us right here on Facebook Live. And let's go ahead and do what we normally do, is find out what we can talk about. If the audio acts right.
Kazual House.
Okay, the NFL is starting to do some tweaking of the COVID testing. I remember last week or the beginning of the week, I spoke a little bit about a possible thing of the false negatives and maybe false positive tests that are making an impact on who has COVID and who does not have COVID. And now that has been a very big issue for the NFL, and now they're starting to tweak some things to change that narrative. So that they're going to do some things. The NFL Players Association are attempting to try to nip this thing in the bud, so to speak, and try to make it as less, you know, mixing of the two as they can. The testing procedures separating false positives results from people that are active infected with the virus. So that's what's been happening. They've been mixing, and then guys are having it. Guys that are asymptomatic have it, and they're coming up with negative tests, and they're, you know, cross, you know, contaminating each other, so to speak. And next thing you know, you got, you know, this thing starting to break out. The testing is an issue, of course. How they do that testing is going to be an issue. Hopefully they got some people on staff that will be able to come in and do those tests. I would imagine they have that now, but because I think they were saying, like, they were just leaving, like, these little packages in the rooms or whatever for the players and to do them themselves. And like I said before, that would be kind of almost impossible to get accurate readings from every last person to do it properly. But the new policy they have that they're going to try to do, tweaking it wise, it's applies to the Tier 1 and Tier 2 employee, including all the players and coaches who produce a positive test or asymptomatic, as it and not known for a history of coronavirus infection. So if that person meets that criteria, the league will require two additional tests within 24 hours. And both of those tests come back negative, then that person will be able to resume activity. So he has to come up with two negative tests within 24 hours before they can get back into the rest of the population. Otherwise, they'll be quarantined. But if, like I said, if they don't pass those tests, they'll be quarantined. And then also, the people that were in the proximity of that person will have to be looked at and quarantined as well, which brings me to my question. And this is what I've been thinking about, too, as far as how hard it's going to be for the NFL to continue to have this season the way they talk about having it. You're talking about if the quarterback room or the running back room or whatever the position is room, if one guy has a false negative or positive and ends up going in saying that he has COVID-19 and he does not actually have it, but he has to be quarantined, well, that's going to mean that the whole quarterback room needs to be quarantined because they were in and around him in that area when they, if you know, should he test positive or negative, whichever one. So I'm thinking, man, they can't have rooms like that like they normally do. The quarterbacks be in the same room, running backs in the same room, having their own thing. Everything has to probably be done by Zoom because if one guy goes positive, the whole room's going into quarantine for 2 weeks. And that's going to be difficult to do. How can you not have your quarterbacks, you know, and all your position guys together to be able to learn or whatever to be taught? Now it's all individual through Zoom. So this is just getting harder and harder and harder. And the NFL is doing all they can, I know, to try to make this thing work. But it's going to be tough on all these staff members, coaches and staff to do these things. Man, it's going to be tough. These changes all came about a week after Detroit Lions quarterback Matthew Stafford was placed on COVID-19 list with one positive test during the league's training camp. But Stafford later tested negative three times and was reinstated to the roster. So these false tests have been an issue. They are trying to nip that in the bud because if you don't, man, it's going to get confusing. I mean, COVID-19, there is no, you know, information telling us how this thing's working, what it's going to do. All we have is just what we have as you know, what we've already experienced, but we don't know what this thing is doing. Nobody does. And if we're going to be going up and down and not knowing who's really tested, who's really positive, who's not, it's going to get really murky. And this NFL season is going to get closer and closer and closer to having that pause in between those in between games, 2 week, 3 week, you know, a hiatus from from the league, from the season. So this thing is going to come down. I mean, this thing is going to definitely, you know, all the procedures, they can do all the procedures they want, but it's going to come down to the players being responsible. I mean, I know we keep saying this, but this is what it's going to come down to, the players doing all that is necessary in the procedures to stay safe. So, I mean, so that's going to mean no parties, Dak. That's going to mean all the rendezvous, the late night rendezvous and all those things are going to have to stop. And that's going to be hard to get every single guy doing those things that are necessary. So that's why I got a feeling this thing is going to at some point hit a very, very big breakout. The uncertainty makes this thing harder, makes it more scarier. At the same time, there is so many opinions about what the virus is going to be doing, what it may not do. But like I said, nobody really knows. So NFL has their hands full. Just guys got to not be stupid out there and think about the next person. That's what it's going to come down to. The NFL is doing some things. I had Kent Summers on, of course, on Wednesday, and we spoke a little bit about what am I looking for here? Where's my – I don't know what I did with it. I had it in my hand. We spoke a little bit about the equipment that they are going to try to use to try to aid in guys tackling each other, guys being in close proximity with each other, you know, spit lids coming out of their mouths while they're spitting and jawing at each other on the field. They're going to try to do some things in the equipment to try to alleviate some of that. And the first thing, of course, we talked about was the shield on the helmet from Oakley. And a lot of guys are saying, I don't want to wear that. But here, that's part of the problem. If this is going to be a solution, then be part of the solution and not part of the problem. But guys are not used to it. They're creatures of habit. I get it. But this is going to be able to keep the season sustained. And if it aids in that and helps that, guys should be willing to be helpful and just wear the freaking thing for one freaking season. I don't think it's going to kill anybody to put on the dang shield, J.J. Watt. Stop bitching in the dang on media about you don't want to wear the doggone thing when it helps the situation. Another thing they're coming up with is a gator-style neck pull-up. Pretty sure everybody has seen it. I had one here I was going to put on to demonstrate, but I had it here. It goes up about right to here, and it goes past the ears, and pretty much everybody pretty much knows what that looks like. The material, though, the one I have is kind of like a you know, woman's leggings that they wear. Those leggings that they wear, the material kind of feels like that. So it's like it's really thin, and I'm pretty sure they can make it thicker if they need to. But if it's thin, you can still breathe. I mean, I had it on earlier today, and I'm breathing just regularly, deep breaths. And so running with that thing on, you should be fine. If that thing gets any thicker, now you're hindering your breathing, and you're talking about hyperventilating, can't breathe. Guy's going to be really going to – that's where the thin line's going to be. You know, how thick should this thing be? Is it thin enough or thick enough to stop the matter in the air that's going around getting into other, you know, where you can breathe in? Is it, you know, thick enough to stop that from going into somebody's nose or mouth? So – well, I don't know. I'm pretty sure they've done a lot of testing on it. There's a lot of masks out there right now that everybody's creating that are not up to par as well. So hopefully the NFL will get up to par knowing which material to use and which material not to use. But it looks like that's going to help the situation. So all the players, man, I just hope they just get on board and just, hey, look, we only got to do this for this season. Let's just do what we got to do to have a season. I mean, between all the opt-outs and the COVID-19 list, a lot of guys are out. A lot of guys are going to be just sitting at home, and a lot of guys are going to be on that list. That list will never, ever, ever be vacant this season. That's guaranteed. Some of these guys, though, are taking advantage of this clause, though. I mean, they have to sit out because they have families that are at risk. They have themselves that are at risk. They have wives that are having children and things of that nature, and they're opting out. But that's to be understood. I mean, it's like, what can you say to a guy that's trying to protect his family? You can't say anything to that guy. But there are certain guys that are in certain situations that are taking advantage of that situation from a different standpoint, from a contract standpoint. I mean, every guy that's sitting out 100% is losing money, that's for sure. But there may be something in a, you know, that they're holding on to that maybe that will benefit them in the long run. And I'm going to give you an example. Right now, every person that sits out for the, that's high risk for COVID, is going to earn $350,000 and an accrued NFL season if they choose to opt out. So if they opt out, they get that $350,000. If they're at high risk, if they're not at high risk, the players that are not high risk will get $150,000 for opting out. So opting out is definitely going to cost you some money, but like I said, there could be some benefits to certain guys. I'm going to give you an example of a receiver. His name Geronimo Allison. Everybody knows the receiver that used to play for the Green Bay Packers. Had a pretty good role with the Green Bay Packers. In fact, I think he was probably the third receiver on the Green Bay Packers. But now he's got picked up by the Detroit Lions, and he has a contract with the Detroit Lions for $910,000. Now he's sitting out. He's opting out. He's not at high risk, as far as I know. They didn't have anything said about him being at high risk, so his salary goes from $910,000 for the year down to $150,000 for that year. And you would go, okay, other than family or risk or whatever, he's doing it for that decision. If it's a money issue, why would you throw away $760,000? Well, when you look at the Detroit Lions roster, he could benefit because he would be, first of all, he's competing for the backup job. That's what he's going in there for. And then so now he would be backing up Kenny Golladay, Marvin Jones, and, of course, Andy Amendola. So his chances of getting on the field to be a starter or to be having a bigger role are very slim with those four, with those three guys plus the other guys he's going to be competing with. But he's going to be throwing away, of course, $760,000 if by opting out. But the flip side of that is the reason why it could benefit him is those guys that are on the Detroit Lions, Golladay, Jones, Amendola, are all in contract years. So now Geronimo Ellis is going, okay, if those guys are all in contract years, there's no way all those guys are coming back next year. So what he's doing, he's going to opt out. That $910,000 is going to roll over next year and get put into the next year's contract anyway. So he's going to get that $150,000 that rich people or can live off of with the money he's already made, of course. So he's able to make that decision for his family and not put himself in a bad situation. Next year, he could be in a better situation because those three wide receivers are in contract years. One of them, I think, Golladay for sure, probably will get extended. That's probably what's going to happen with Detroit. But still, Allison was very, very good with Rodgers in Green Bay. So if he can get that opportunity next year, now he can get a bigger role, bigger contract, and he's sitting pretty. So a lot of guys got different decisions they're making with this whole thing. And so it all comes down to wherever you are with your family. You know your family bigger, better, I mean, better than anybody else. But the bigger the name is on the list, the bigger the money we're dealing with. And everybody knows that. Look, there's another situation with Star Latulele from Buffalo. I mean, top of the line defensive tackle. Guys, you know, balling out. Signs a 5-year deal for 10. For what did he sign that deal for? 5-year. He had a 5-year deal in 2018 for $50 million. $50 million in 2018. This year, they restructured that contract, giving him a $4.5 million signing bonus, guaranteed. But now that he's opt out, that contract won't start until 2021. So he knows that money's going to be guaranteed, but a year from now. So he's going to take a little break and do what he has to do, you know, for his family and make that either $350,000 or $150,000, whichever one it is, as far as him being at risk or not for COVID-19, he's opting out, and that whole contract is on pause until the next season. So everybody has a different situation, and it's pretty unique, though, but it's at the same time very, very, very unprecedented unprecedented how this season is going down. And we've never seen anything like this. We've never did, and everything is almost to a point where it's on the fly. You're just kind of making this thing up as you go. And guys are just making those decisions for themselves. And I'm hoping this season doesn't just look and feel like a watered down season. You know, where how right now everybody's talking about putting an asterisk behind the NBA season. Whoever wins that title is going to have an asterisk behind it. I hope the NFL doesn't get to that point where it starts to feel like that, because we had a lot of guys opt out. Key guys. The New England Patriots lost 8 guys and chunk guys that were really part of their whole deal for being, you know, a good team next year. I mean, offensive tackle Marcus Cannon, linebacker Dante Hightower. I mean, key guys, Patrick Chung. Those are guys that made the Patriots who the Patriots are on defense. And then, of course, your offensive tackle. So I know Bill Belichick will do what Belichick does to fix those things. And at the same time, COVID-19 list and opting out players have opened up the windows for those guys that are free agents now. Those guys that are free agents right now didn't get the deals they were looking for when free agency opened up, and they've been sitting out for quite a bit of time right now. I mean, Jadeveon Clowney, I would imagine, would get looked at again. I remember the Patriots were in talks about bringing him in a while ago before all this happened, and they were like, no, they weren't interested. But I would imagine after losing Dante Hightower and all these other guys that you're losing, I would imagine you'll start to see Everson Griffin's name, Clowney's name, and all these guys that haven't signed yet. You'll start to see their names kind of pop off the screen there and be associated with the New England Patriots. Matter of fact, I wouldn't be surprised you start seeing that like right away. But anyway, it is almost time for us to take a break here. What else are we going to talk about? The NFL is pretty much taking most of the conversation here. Speaking of the Patriots, I just saw the press conference with Cam Newton getting introduced to the media. The Patriots media, and boy, he's smiling just like cheek to cheek, like way, but at the same time, looking like, man, I know y'all seen it already, what he's got on, got like this cross thing between Madea and Big Mama. He kind of it just looks so weird. I don't know what kind of style that he's trying to portray, but I mean, it's his, and it is what it is, but he just looked funny to me. Oh, man. But I think he'll be fine, though, with New England, though, to be honest with you. Like I said, Bill Belichick will make him better and make him look good. He will make him shine in New England. I do believe that, even with having not had him played in that system or whatever it may be, he will get him playing to the level he needs to play to make him look good. I promise you that. Just ask Matt Castle. And ask that 6th-round draft pick with no athleticism, no the arm not as strong, new kid out of University of Michigan. Ask him, is he going to make him better and make him look good? And that's another story. Y'all talking about the GOAT, but I ain't on board with all that right now. You already know my stance on that. But anyway, systems make quarterbacks. But anyway, let's turn to the D-backs real quick. They finally get a winning streak going, 2 games in a row right now. Is this hopefully the turning point where they can get shifting into what we see on paper and be playing like what we see on paper, particularly from the pitching standpoint? We got to see those starting pitchers start to do their jobs a lot better. They're hitting the ball a little bit better now. They're hitting the ball in major crutch situations better now. So hopefully they can continue that going forward. Robbie Ray has to get going. Robbie Ray has had way too many years to be Robbie Ray. The first time we've seen him, the first year he played, he has not been back to that status yet. He has to get back there or better, and he has not gotten back there yet. And I had Ed and the guys on yesterday, and I was asking, is it time to just switch that guy with Alex Young and just make Robbie Ray the 7th and 8th guy coming in, and 7th and 8th inning guy coming in, because he tends to be he can strike guys out, but he still tends to kind of lose it every once in a while and put a lot of guys on base by walk, a lot of guys getting home runs off of him. So maybe he's better off not having to pitch more than those 2 innings. So I don't know. That's just a question. But since things are going in the right direction, I'm pretty sure Lovello is not going to touch it. He's already said it. So we'll see. We'll see if this is the Diamondbacks' time to start to show what they really should look like from what we see on paper. What we're going to do is take a quick break here, our first break. And we are going to come back and talk about the hit our Phoenix Suns took today in the playoff bubble down there in Orlando. Is it a death blow, or is it still a little light at the end of the tunnel getting into that playoff spot? You don't want to miss what we're coming up with next. Stick around, Suns Nation. We'll be right back. This is the Kazual Sportz Show. Earl Burnett. We'll be right back.
Alexa, who is the number one radio station on the web?
KSRN, the hottest internet radio station on the web. If you have a podcast or have music and want to be heard, drop us a line at www.ksrnaz.com. The exclusive voice of the Bird Gang, your Kazual Sportz Radio Network.
This is the sound of a racing heart. It's beating a little faster because it belongs to a young child. But this child isn't in the middle of a close soccer game or playing with her puppy in the yard. Her heart is racing because she's just been told she has to move foster homes again. Change a child's story. There's a child waiting for a volunteer like you. Learn how you can help at CasaForChildren.org.
Larry
has returned.
Larry.
You need Larry.
Send a message.
Larry.
Fitzgerald
has returned.
This is Larry Fitzgerald. You listen to the exclusive voice of the Bird Gang, Kazual Sportz.
You are listening to the best internet radio station on the web, KSRN, Arizona.
This is Cliff Kingsbury, and you're listening to the second best sounding voice in the valley, Kazual E, on the Kazual Sportz Show here on KSRN, Arizona.
All right, welcome back into the Kazual House, Bird Gang, Suns Nation, Diamondback Nation, all the fans out there in the valley. It is the Kazual Sportz Show, Earl Burnett. We're going to go ahead and continue with our Suns talk. One second here. All right.
six threes for Devin Booker. Booker, four to shoot. Gets to the elbow. Good contest by Reggie Jackson, but Devin Booker with points 32 and 33. Put the Suns out in front by two. Six to play. Booker, this is for the win. Got it! Wow!
What a shot by Devin Booker.
Yes. That still got us high, even after the Indiana game has already been played. That shot still is going to ring out all over everywhere right now. And so D-Book is starting to turn some heads now, finally, as far as, you know, getting the notoriety that he deserves. But they took a little bit of a hit today in the standings as far as the race in that playoff race. I have my little math thing going all week long, trying to make sure every little number and every little thing to get them in this dang playoff spot. But they took a pretty big hit today because I did not anticipate the Spurs losing to Utah. And they end up losing, and I did not anticipate that Memphis would destroy my dang own prediction and actually win a game, and they ended up winning the game. So those two things have put the Suns a little bit more at a disadvantage. But it's not over yet. It's not over yet. You still have now three teams that you have to kind of – well, not three. We'll take away the eighth seed, so you got two more teams, you being one of the two still to get into that spot. So it's not over yet. They still have a shot at this thing. San Antonio's remaining schedule is still pretty tough, but they're playing pretty good. And, you know, Pop gets that team balling the way they play. They're going to be tough to beat regardless. So Portland is looking like – Portland looked like they should be the 2 or 3 seed right now. But they're going to be tough to stop. Suns' chances are still slim. But let's hope they don't lose their enthusiasm because they're looking at the standings right now. Let's hope they don't lose that same edge that they've been playing with because of those circumstances that the other teams are not winning for them. So I want to see how they perform the more pressure packed this thing gets. I want to see how they perform. I want to see how they go from every game that is counting, and it keeps counting, but the last one could be the one to get you in and you need to win. I want to see that pressure mount up for them because they need that. Devin Booker needs that. Can he get them over that hump to get them to that playoff spot? Or, hey, go ahead and try to win out, win as many as you can, and, you know, the rest that when it's over with, it's not in your hands. You did what you were supposed to do, so hopefully they don't lose the edge. I don't think they will lose the edge because Monty Williams has just been the perfect coach for this team. And I played it all week long, and I'm going to play it again today because this is the soundbite that this is the soundbite that just made me say this is going to be my soundbite for a long time because Monty Williams spoke to his team. And I said this before, I'm going to preface this for you. He spoke to the team before going into the bubble, a couple of days before they went off to go into the Orlando bubble, and he knew exactly what his team was going to do, and he knew exactly what they were going up there to do, and he knew it would play out, I guess, this way.
We're building a platform, and the league is starting to respect who you are and what you've done. And we're going to get closer together. And I'm like you. I want to go down there and destroy everyone in our way. And so you guys know I love you. We're going to embrace hard. We're going to knock down every obstacle that's in front of us. And I can't wait to get to work.
So far, they are doing exactly that. Destroying every team that is in their way. So now Miami's in their way. Can they come up with another rabbit out of their hat and play as sound as they've been playing? Because it's not like they're just stumbling into wins. They are playing with a style that I had to go back and continue to look at on tape and watch. What are they doing? What's different? And what I see that is different, Booker is key to the whole thing because he's a lot different. He knows this offense in and out. And when they're running their sets, you can tell every man is doing exactly what they're supposed to do. Nothing looks out of order. Nothing looks like somebody doesn't know what they're doing. There's not too many missed assignments. And you know that's happening when you don't have as many turnovers as they used to have. So when you look at it on tape, you can see they're a good team now. It's like, okay, I mean, they're not in the caliber right now, of course, in the top eight seeds right now because they're not a playoff team currently. But still, you talk about going forward next year. If they execute the way they're executing right now, they could beat anybody. Because the key is Booker. Booker's been a really very, very good delegator when he has the ball in his hands and being willing to give it up at the right time to the right person at the right time. And he's been doing that excellent job at doing that in this bubble. He's cut down his turnovers with the ball handling. He used to handle the ball and kind of bounce it off his leg every once in a while. Now he's really sound with what he's doing. He's making decisions that are calculated. He knows exactly where he was going. That last shot he hit at the end of that game, in that Clipper game, he was calculated where he was going. He wasn't just trying to scramble and put something together. You can tell because his first move was a fake pass to whoever was coming off the screen at the top. He fake passed it to them and went into the deep of the teeth of the defense. He knew who was guarding him. So I got to get that guy up in the air. Boom, he gets one guy up in the air, and the other guy fouls him. George fouled him on that play. He hit his hand and his arm and everything, and he still, got himself enough space and to see the rim, and boom. He was calculated. He knew exactly what he was doing. That's what superstars do. And if he is going to be like that, and I know there's still a lot of naysayers that say he's not that caliber of a superstar yet, but he is on his way. If he can play like that, make guys around him better, which he has done in this bubble, he has done that. Those young guys are looking better. They are feeding off his energy just alone. So if he can continue to do those things, they're going to be a pretty tough team to beat next year. They're going to be a tough team to beat now in this bubble for teams that are still trying to get into whatever playoff seeding they're trying to continue to get in. Suns might start to destroy a few things here for some of these other teams, even if they don't get in. So regardless, the way they're playing is so sound, and it just speaks volumes. It speaks their coach loud and clear. What you see on the court, you see from their coach. And so Monty knew what he was doing when he said that quote, "We're going to go down and we're going to destroy everybody in our way." He knew it. And it's like it's playing right out the way he said it because he knew. He knows his team better than anybody else. But now that Devin Booker is on the display and that big shot has rang across the world, now he's probably starting to get a few of these free agents to start to try to talk about him because there's one guy from another team in the West that had some words to say about D-Book.
It's great to see Book playing well and Phoenix playing well, but get my man out of Phoenix. It's not good for him. It's not good for his career. Sorry, Chuck. But
wow.
They got to get Book out of Phoenix. I need my man to go somewhere where he can play great basketball all the time and win because he's that type of player.
Are you tampering?
Maybe.
Man, that's a lot in that quote he just said. I need my man. Oh, you need him? Yeah, you need him to get out of Phoenix? Yeah, why? Yeah, okay, so that could be some tampering a little bit for Draymond Green. You know he's going to say what he has to say. But before we attack Draymond about that quote, before everybody says, "Man, that's the dumbest thing ever." Okay, yeah, of course, Phoenix right now is not we're thinking that way. But let's not forget that every last person, maybe I'm gonna say like every person, but most of us in the Valley was the same way about Larry Fitzgerald. Before he got Kyler Murray and his new team that he has right now. Everybody was kind of like, man, I want to see him go get a ring. Let's just let him go and let him go get a ring. Everybody was thinking that. I know I was. That was my thought process. His career is almost over with. He's still got some talent. Go ahead and go to New England and get a ring. Let's let this dude get a ring. Everybody was saying that about Larry. So what makes it any different with Book? He's been losing. Now, what makes it different now is Monty Williams now, of course. This new team, they're starting to turn a corner now. You can see the light at the end of the tunnel. So Draymond is not paying attention to what he's seeing right now. Draymond is looking at the superstar and going, oh, they're going to do that might just fit with us. And so he's throwing it out there, and a lot of other people are going to start throwing it out there too. Can Book stay focused? Can Book stay focused on where they are right now? Can he see the light at the end of the tunnel? And he must be able to, because otherwise he wouldn't be so locked into what Monty has him doing. And so Draymond was just kind of doing some tampering and wanted to see him in Golden State, probably. I don't know. And a lot of other guys are going to start doing the same exact thing. So that just lets us know that D-Book is finally getting the recognition that is well-deserved, because the kid plays hard. The kid is talented. He's not just a shooter. He is a scorer. He is now also adding a little bit more effort on defense. So he's trying to round his game off, round his game out, I should say, to be that tier one caliber all-star in this league. So still going to be tough to see him get in an all-star game just on a vote, unless he started doing things like that every night, of course. But, I mean, you got Klay Thompson coming back. Curry will be back at full strength. You got, I mean, all these guys in the West are just piling the West up. It's going to still be hard to see him overtake some of these guys, but I think he can still do it. I think he's talented enough. I think he'll have the pieces around him to be able to do it. I spoke a little bit about Kelly Oubre with the Ed Cole and Paul yesterday, and they all have come to the conclusion that the way this team is playing right now, that Oubre may be the trading piece to get them the power forward they're looking for. Because as of right now, the chemistry is so dang good. If Oubre was to be thrown into this chemistry right now, it would be totally awkward and destroyed. Because Oubre is like good player. Trust me. I'm not saying he's not a good player. This would be a guy that a lot of teams in the playoffs right now would love to have on their team, six man or whatever. But he tends to stop the ball. And you can see the Suns team, like I said, that system they're running, whatever they're doing, everybody's everywhere they need to go. That ball is moving. It's flying across the court. It's flying back and forth from side to side, weak side to strong side. It's going all over the place, and then it ends up in the hands after a pick and roll at the top, and Ayton gets it or whatever. Whoever's getting the ball is getting the ball because the ball is moving around. It's being shared. Oubre kind of holds that thing a little bit and takes ill-advised three-pointers and ill-advised shots and gets a little bit out of control sometimes. At the same time, he gets hot a lot, and you got to ride him. So it's like that chemistry that he would have with this current team right now, I don't think it's going to work. So you got to go ahead and turn him and get that power forward that you've been trying to get, that you've been covered in for a long time. So we'll see. We'll see what the Suns do. I'm hoping that they go ahead and, I mean, we can't complain about what James Jones has done thus far. I know in the beginning, everybody was wondering what he was doing. Like, what is that move? What is that move? You know, but he has made every move right now that has worked for this team. So, currently team. I mean, I know there were some past moves that he made, of course, wasn't here, but he still had to make the moves to get rid of those pieces too. So, he's still making good moves to improve this team. And they are improved. His work is paying off. Let's just hope that he can attract that next star power forward to come here. And I think D-Book and Ayton would be, you know, pretty good pieces to look at going forward for somebody who want to come here. DeAndre Ayton, everybody needs him. All of us need him as fans and whatever to play like he played in that Indiana game. He needs to play exactly like that. If he can play like that, and I'm not just talking about the 23 and 11 rebounds. I'm not talking about that scoring, although that's you know, icing on the cake. I'm talking about the intensity that he played with. I'm talking about the engagement that he played with. He did not seem lost or kind of like losing sight of what the team is trying to do. He stayed engaged, and at the same time, he did something that I was hoping he would have done when Booker fouled out a couple of games ago. When Booker fouled out of that game, I was going, okay, this is DA's time right here. He's going to take over. Just throw it down to him and let him have it. And I was hoping he would be demanding that ball and demanding to give it, you know, to come his way. But he didn't. He got passive, and Rubio kind of took that thing over a little bit. But in the Indiana game, there was a time in that first half where the Suns were a little bit stagnant. D-Book went out, maybe a couple of fouls, and they were just stagnant, going back and forth. And Ayton kept them alive in that game, kept them in that game. They kept feeding him, and he kept delivering. And not only scoring, his pick and rolls were excellent. His engagement at blocking shots, he had 4 blocks in that game. That's when you know he's engaged. That's when you know he is focused, when he's getting blocks. When he's not getting blocks and he's not shooting from the free throw line, he's not being aggressive. So that Ayton makes this team that much better. If we get that Ayton every night, this team's going to be tough to beat. And as they get better and better and better next year you could be looking at it, the next Phoenix Suns playoff team. And I know my man Sean's going to echo those words for sure, because that's his team, him and Paul. But they both were on that narcotic. We talked about that yesterday with Paul. He'd been on that narcotic. He was the only one on it, too, for a long time. Now he got everybody sharing that thing. And he said he's the leader of the Carter house. But I got some time here. I'm going to dump into the Cardinals real quick here. Normally I would take a quick break, but nope, I just went past my break. So we're going to go ahead and go to the Cardinals here. And our division continues to try to make moves to better themselves. And we have to just deal with it, I guess, because they got more cap space than we do right now. The Seattle Seahawks are targeting Everson Griffin and Clay Matthews and or. I think Griffin makes more sense, of course, because Matthews is 34, Griffin's 32. I don't know why I thought Matthew was older than that. I don't know why I thought he was older than that. I don't know why I thought Matthew was way, way older than 34. But I'm going to go into this Cardinal talk, but I'm going to have the other half of the Kazual Sportz show come on with me. And he does this new segment. I think we got a new segment here. It's called 5-Minute Closet with Sean McConnell. What's going on, man? let me get you plugged in, man. Hold on a second. Man, I'm having to run all this technology, man. I got to do all these things now myself. I'm forgetting things. But can you hear me now? Sean, you there?
Yeah, I'm here. You hear
man,
me?
Okay, yeah, I can hear you now. Man, so many dang buttons, man. Click, 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 click. Oh, you got to do that one, too. You got to hit that one, too. Like, damn. I'm straight running my own board here and have to run a dang show. But that is what it is, man. But, yeah, man, you're going to give us that 5-minute closet tick tonight. So what's going on, man? What's on your mind?
Man, what's on my mind? Just seeing the confidence of the Suns out the gate against Indiana. They knew exactly what they were dealing with T.J. Warren and all the hype that was going into that game, and they shut it down
exactly,
from the start. Right? Two
exactly.
big runs yep. in that game. I mean, we're talking about the Suns in big runs.
Right.
That doesn't happen.
Right. That's a good
That just doesn't happen. And then, secondly, the Coyotes winning their first playoff series in God knows how long. Shout out to the Coyotes. Are you kidding me? What is going on right now? We get DeAndre Hopkins and some playoff action by hockey and basketball potentially because of coronavirus?
Man.
Who would have thunk of that?
Yeah. I mean, you don't want to sound all saying the wrong thing, but thanking coronavirus is like, for us, we thanking it. But, I mean, from a sports standpoint, it has helped.
Yeah, sports fan in Arizona, I think, might take it.
Yeah, exactly. It has helped. I mean, that stoppage, especially for the NBA, that stoppage for the players, for the Suns, I guess got them refocused to you know, see what Monty's concept is. And, I mean, to study a playbook, having already played in it already, now you can study it a little bit more and then pick up the concept of what he's trying to do. So, I don't know. I don't know what the actual key thing is of why they're playing so good. I know it's Monty. I know it's Monty and Monty's system and Monty's culture changing and all those things. But at the same time, it's also a change of heart and change of mind of those players. So, and Book has done.
Earl, do you think at all that some of these teams are just letting off the gas a little bit? I mean, the Suns are the only undefeated team left in the bubble. But do you think these veteran teams, especially like the top four seeds on each side, are not really worried about these little scrimmage games?
I think that's have a lot to do with it, yes. I think the Lakers and Clippers are kind of easing off the gas a little bit. They don't really have anything to play for. I mean, they
but
don't
But you saw Kawhi. I mean, he was pissed that Booker hit that shot.
Oh, he sure was. George was, too. But at the same time, what I mean by they don't have anything to – the Clippers had something to play for, but, you know, having no fans and no home court advantage almost eliminates having something to play for when you're that high at the top, you know, seeding-wise. So
I yeah, because the Suns are used to not having fans around.
I guess. But, yeah, I think you're
right. They've been used to that for a while.
I think you're right. Some of these teams that are at the top are. But I think some of these guys like Milwaukee and all these guys are still playing hard because that East is like is still a toss-up. But with that no fans,
that's true.
With no fans and stuff like that, it still makes it kind of like, wow, what are they playing for? But you want to be playing your best basketball going into the playoffs. That's why these teams that are, if they are letting off the gas a little bit, that's going to come back to bite them. Because if you're the Lakers right now and you let off that gas, and the catastrophic happens that Portland makes it in, and that's your eighth seed opponent, you are in a lot of trouble. I'm telling you, you could get eliminated in the first round by that team. Because the Lakers
that's
have
true.
Two players. Two players, and the rest of these other guys haven't caught up to those two players yet. And Portland is a seasoned, well-oiled machine, especially in the backcourt. So I don't think anybody wants to see them get in, but I'm going to tell you they're getting in. So
I was talking to a friend. They said it might come down to a play-in game with Portland and Phoenix, and I said I would hate to have to deal with a play-in game against Damian Lillard.
Oh, my goodness. Oh my!
Damian Lillard in a playing situation, forget it. He might go for 70.
I can't say I would hate it, but it would definitely be scary. But to see them in that type of game would be awesome to see how they react in it. But yes, anybody that has to face that dude is definitely shaking in their shoes a little bit, because
that'd be brutal.
Yeah, he is. I don't think he even has the same blood we all have. I think that dude is an alien, dude. I am not lying. That dude must have green blood or something. Because how does he do what he does? I have no idea. It's like his demeanor doesn't change. He's just eats you alive and just walk off the court with that silent little, you know, he doesn't say much. It's like,
and then
go
drop a rap album the next day.
go to his little a hotel room and go ahead and mix a tape or something. Yeah, that's. Man, the dude is awesome. I would love to see them eliminate one of these high top seeds because I got a feeling it's going to happen. I got a feeling.
Now I'm looking at the preview for tomorrow. They're playing Miami at 4:30, and it looks like Dragic is day-to-day and Butler is out. So
okay. That
might really change the dynamic of that Miami game.
That was part of our show yesterday. We were wondering. I told Paul, I said, man, Butler might not play. And Dragic is limping a little bit, so they might hold him out. He's like, I don't think so. I was like, okay, we'll see. And so now?
Says he's been ruled out officially.
Okay, so the Suns' opportunity has just gotten better. And now they win that game. They at least pull back ahead of the Spurs because that was a hit today. The Spurs winning was another hit today. And I'm not sure what's going on in that Pelicans game. They're playing the last place Washington Wizards. And they should win that game, but let's just hope Washington just decides to do us another favor like everybody else has done. But, yeah, man, what is your thoughts right now with the depth of the Arizona Cardinals offensive line having Marcus Gilbert now opting out?
I am not that worried about Gilbert opting out. I mean, there's going to be players – all over the league that are going to be opting out. I think we have to really kind of see matchup wise where that really hurts us. If say we play, you know, pick a team and one of their top pass rushers wants to opt out,
right. That
would help us because then it kind of evens out. Right. But,
correct.
I feel like we kind of set up our offensive line to kind of be a little bit plug and play kind of like it was last year, even though we found some continuity. Right. I think we prepared ourselves for a little bit of a plug-and-play situation. And that depth, having these guys play multiple positions, will help us, although you do want continuity. And I know all of our guests would attest to that. But,
yeah.
You know, people get injured, and you have to prepare for that. And this is kind of the same boat. You're basically just saying Gilbert is out for a year with an injury. It's the same concept. So
exactly.
We have that prepared for. And I think with Murray's ability to, you know, elude pressure and get out of the pocket, it's really kind of, you know, what offensive line?
Right.
Murray's going to be running around anyway.
Exactly. They wondering about him. So, I get. Yeah, that's a good point. I mean, they have a lot of depth in every position on that offensive line. And then signing, like you said, Kelvin Beachum and then the other guy, a new guy just got on there, Coda Martin. I mean, they're just stacking guys just in case, like you said, with this new COVID-19 thing, you just have no idea who's going to be on the shelf for 2 weeks and who's not. So, I mean, the starting lineup, mm-hmm. Humphreys, Pugh, Cole, Sweezy, and then that last right tackle is still wide open. I still think that's Murray, of course, because he has more experience and he has been there last year. He's in that system for that year. But this opens up an opportunity for the rookie Josh Jones as well, which I thought would not even get a chance to be on the field this year because of the COVID-19. All those rookies I thought would be on the shelf this year. That's just my opinion. Is he that high of a draft choice where you got to get him on the field right now? I don't think he is. Josh Jones is. Simmons, yes, but not Josh Jones. But now this Marcus Gilbert opting out gives him a little bit more of an opportunity to get some reps to get caught up. The only thing's going to come down to how fast can he pick up the NFL game coming from the college game.
Right, and at least, like you said, bringing in Beachum and other guys, that would give him a little bit of a buffer to kind of pick that up.
Right. We never had a chance to talk about this. Listen to this soundbite. We haven't talked about this yet.
Felt great. Felt good. Gave me chills. Not going to lie, man. It felt real good to be part of a great organization. And, you know, man, the Cardinal red and white and black look good on me, if I do say so myself.
Yeah, you sure do. It sure did look good, didn't it? I saw the uniform thing, and it just, I think every Cardinal fan probably had this same thing happen. Oh, it's really happened. He really is in a Cardinal.
Yeah, it's real now.
It's real. I think everybody had that. So yeah, that's what it felt like to me. It looked awesome when he was looking in that red, man. But man, I appreciate you coming in and giving us that Sean McConnell take that we always, you know, that's what the Kazual Sportz show is about, man. Appreciate it.
Being trapped in the closet, talking about sports, man.
Yeah, hopefully we get you in here Monday for a full show. That'd be awesome. But then if not, hey.
I'm planning on it.
Oh, okay, cool. So then we got the 5-minute closet if we don't, and then we got you live on Monday. So that's the one and only second half of the Kazual Sportz show, my man. Sean McConnell, no other like him. I want to go ahead and do one segment that I haven't done in a while. Okay, maybe not.
Sports Almanac.
Technical difficulties.
What we're gonna do right here is go back, way back, back into time.
That's a 5 seconds left in the game. Do you believe in miracles? Yes!
Get ready to duck it down, boy. Get ready to duck it down, boy.
Back down memory lane.
It's Lillard. He got the shot off. Oh, my God! And the Blazers win the series.
I remember it vividly.
Here comes Richardson. Here's the throw from Marquez. Richardson is safe. Derek Jeter ends his final game with a walk-off single. Derek Jeter.
This is it. I remember.
Sports Almanac.
A lot of things went down in the sports world on this same day of August 7th in sports history. 1991, Carl Lewis. Carl Lewis with the four relay guys that were running with him, Leroy Burrell, Dennis Mitchell, all broke the world record in the relay, 37.67 seconds in 1991. And I'm pretty sure Usain and them killed that a couple of years later somewhere down history. 1992, the Orlando Magic signed NBA number one draft pick, Shaquille O'Neal. 92, man, that goes back. And then also in 2000, this same day in history, the Los Angeles Lakers announced the retirement of former player, executive vice president, Jerry West. And he's had that that organization hasn't been the same since he left. But one star player that made a good GM, because it's not too many other ones out there. We were talking to Paul and him yesterday about that. Why does role players make better coaches than GMs? And he said that superstars, the game and everything comes so easy to them. They want everybody to do it their way, the same way they do it, the same way they think it. But a role player has to learn it. The role player can see more. So I agree with that. But Jerry West was one of the best ones to do it, to come in and be a GM. Then you got 2007 San Francisco Giants. Barry Bonds hits 756 career home run to break Hank Aaron's longstanding MLB record. And, of course, we know he had some aid in that, doing that. And then also 2010, Jerry Rice and Emmitt Smith goes into the Hall of Fame together. Two of the major, major names in sports went in together in football in 2010. And so that's our history on this day of August 7th. Pretty cool. And that is another edition of the Kazual Sportz Show. Our first week has completed. And, man, it was pretty cool. Thank you to all the guests all week long. Thank you, Bird Gang, Suns Nation, Diamondbacks Nation, all week long for tuning in to the show. We will catch you next week. Peace out.